to be here today to talk with you about the future of education and the work that we're doing with young people. And I think it's really important to ground this conversation in what it is that we're facing today. And if you have been in a classroom in the last 4 years, you know that things have been kind of hard. You can pull headlines from many, many different places. And we know, particularly for our kids in K-12 school, that we're still seeing the effects of school closures, hybrid learning, remote learning, all of the trauma that came out of COVID for our students and for our teachers. We're still seeing enormous declines in attendance. We're starting to see an increase in learning that's happening, but nowhere close to where we were prior to the pandemic. And when we are seeing that recovery, we're not necessarily seeing it equally for all kids. We're definitely seeing the gaps that we had before widen, and kids with more affluence and more access doing better post-COVID, and kids, primarily low-income kids, students of color, actually doing worse than they were. We're also seeing a real epidemic, I think, of the kinds of distractions that have happened when students have spent more and more and more time in a virtual space using social media rather than an in-person space in classrooms. And teachers are really struggling with what it is that they can do to get kids to come back in. It's not all terrible. There are some really good things that are happening. I think we just heard a little bit about the new innovations with technology. So AI in classrooms is certainly beginning to take hold, and people are harnessing it, sometimes in good ways, sometimes maybe in not good ways. But it gives us this opportunity to think about, is this an opportunity to do things differently, particularly for adolescents? Can we rethink what school looked like? How is it that we can harness technology in positive ways? And what are some of the innovations that started during COVID that we should embrace, that we should think about continuing, that we should build on as positive things? I think the most important thing that we should be doing is we should be figuring out how is it that we can get kids back into classrooms? Because as one student said, my goal for this year is to actually learn because I didn't learn last year. And so if that's the landscape, what does that mean? And why do I think this is so important? Well, the reason I think it's so important is I'm a career educator. This is a picture of March 12th, 2020. I was the superintendent in the Denver Public Schools, and this was the day that we were announcing that we were going to go on what I was calling at that point an extended spring break. We thought it was going to be 3 weeks. It turned into many, many, many weeks as we grappled with the shutdown from COVID, as we tried to figure out what is school even going to look like, as we tried to determine what does it mean to give a quality education in a landscape where everything is upside down. And so it's really personal to me. It's really important to me. And as I look back, I have my own personal regrets. I have my own personal thoughts about what I wish I had done differently. But I think it's really important to think about the future of education in the context of where we've been. So in 2020, there were over 14 million students who were chronically absent. And adjusting and addressing the learning conditions is going to be so important for us as we think about that. Colorado is a negative outlier when it comes to chronic absenteeism. What we know in Colorado is that we had last year a 31% chronic absentee rate. 31% chronic absentee means that there are 31% of the kids who are missing at least 10% of the school year. Colorado also is an outlier in the number of schools that have a 4-day school week. So think about our rural districts, our mountain communities, places where kids are maybe traveling a fair distance to get to school. Many of those districts, 124 of our districts, only have school 4 days a week. And we've got 30 of those districts that are above the state average. There's one district that pops to mind where 60% of their kids are missing more than 10% of 140 days. So their kids are coming to school maybe 120, maybe 125 days in a school year, and there's no way that we're going to address those headlines if kids aren't in school. It's going to be really important. And I think it's really important for us to think about, when we think about the future of education, what have we said was quality in the past? How is it that we thought about a good school experience in the past? And, you know, are these headlines something new and different that we have to consider? Well, when you go back in time, if you think about a nation at risk in the 1980s, there were really dire pronouncements. In fact, Howard Gardner said, the educational foundations of our society are presently being eroded by a rising tide of mediocrity that threatens the very future of our nation and our future as a people. And that kicked off a whole series of reforms, the standards movement, standardized testing, No Child Left Behind. You can even point to a nation at risk for the race to the top innovations in the Obama era. So lots of work that went into creating quality school experiences. And many of those things just came to a screeching halt when COVID hit. We stopped standardized testing while we were doing that. We had a period of time where we really didn't know what was going on with kids. And we do know that COVID has had an impact on learning time through the school closures, on that dramatic shift to virtual learning, and what it has done in terms of where we are. One of the most distressing pieces of research that I've looked at is this piece here that says that those school closures worldwide in that spring of 2020 likely have led to the loss of 14 million lives, years of life lost. And that's by looking at education levels correlate very strongly to longevity in life, to employment levels. Lower levels of education attainment correlate negatively to higher incidences of alcoholism and health concerns. And when you think about kids who are far behind and not catching up, this could have lifelong impacts for our students. And so it's going to be really important for us to do that. It's also had tremendous impacts on the mental health for our students, for our staff as well, but really for our students, it really is, I think, an epidemic in what we're doing to support our young people who are grappling with higher rates of depression and anxiety. And when you think about a quality school experience, we've got to be able to think about how is it that we support kids as they're coming in if they're grappling with those issues. So there are lots of places to look to about what quality looks like in the future. One of the areas that I have found to be most inspirational is the work of an organization called Transcend. They've created a framework that looks at like quality learning for the future for 21st century classrooms. They've created this tool they call the Leaps for 21st Century Learning. And it describes a new vision of what school could look like. Created it pre-pandemic. And I was really interested to find out like how much of this is valid for what people are grappling with today. So I did some research. I talked with superintendents from across the country. The superintendent names that you see here are all anonymous. Some folks from Colorado, from other parts of the country, big districts, little districts, rural districts, to get a sense from them. What was your experience coming out of COVID? And what should we be doing differently to make sure that we get our kids back on track? And so they shared with me, they also had like a variety of years of experience. And they shared with me their thoughts on this. So what they have shared with me is that now more than ever, we need to focus on culture in schools. We really need to be thinking about how we are creating quality school experiences with positive school cultures. Because if we don't, schools, teachers, and kids will struggle. That we need to be really supporting our educators to have positive mindsets. And for many educators, I think the exhaustion of the COVID pandemic, the lack of substitute teachers, for example, makes it really challenging to have a positive mindset about the work that they're doing with young people. And that at the core, kids can't learn if they're not in a place where they've got positive relationships with the adults around them. So I want to talk a little bit about what the superintendent shared with me. Beth Marsh, who is a superintendent in a large urban district, shared this. Teachers aren't leaving schools with strong culture. The pandemic was like a typhoon that hit, and when it left, we saw which buildings were really standing. I mean, this is an analogy from my Sunday school class, right? She said, like, literally, you could see the schools with strong foundations. Those schools bounced back in terms of culture. Those schools got their families back in. COVID revealed which leaders were really strong to begin with and which places were kind of rocky. And so now more than ever, we need to be investing in what it looks like to create positive cultures in our schools to help our educators get kids back in. Herbert Wallace talked about the role of educator mindsets. And what he shared was there's this huge opportunity for us to be thinking about how we eliminate deficit thinking and beliefs around a student, to really have these high expectations and think about students being filled with possibility. But I notice when I go into some of our secondary schools in particular, he shared, kids are in this place of hiding. And he described kids with their hoodie over their head, closing it so there's just a tiny little hole and almost trying to disappear right there in the building. It's like the equivalent, the in-person equivalent of turning your camera off. And kids spent so much time during COVID with cameras off. But the most important thing we can do now is create a cadre of educators who believe deeply in what kids are capable of doing and can pull them out and metaphorically turn the camera back on. And then finally, Winnie Newton shared this about the role of positive relationships. I think that human connection, she shared, the lack of invisibility is paramount. And of course, now, you know, at a time when our kids need this social emotional learning support, social emotional learning is a dirty term. We're having to find other ways to talk about that work that doesn't send people into the stratosphere. But I think connection now is incredibly important. And, you know, obviously, Winnie's talking a little bit about the culture wars that are happening in schools and how is it that we can create an environment where we talk about connection and belonging without that turning into something that's political. And so what the superintendent shared with me and what I really deeply believe in, that the future of our schools depends on our opportunities to increase real world and career focused learning, that kids will come back in and they'll take the hoodie off when they have the opportunity to be engaged in something that gets them hands-on with something that connects them to their future, that we need to recognize that learning happens not just inside school, but 24 hours a day, wherever we are, and that we should give value to that and actual credit to that, and that we need to create classrooms and schools that recognize student agency, their choices, and their voices in the learning that they want to do. And so what Herbert said was, we're talking about how do you start this work even earlier, not in high school, but even all the way back at the elementary level, where we're talking about career interests or content interests, because if we wait until high school, it's way too late. I think we can start providing these experiences, he said, much earlier. So kids are thinking about what they're interested in before they get there, and they're ready to follow their passions and be excited about coming to school each day. Real world learning creates a different kind of space for kids to learn. On anywhere, anytime learning, Nathan Nichols shared with me, works in a very small rural district. I think it makes sense that we start to recognize when kids are out there learning, they should get credit for it. He works in a small rural community. He said, when our kids are working on the farm, they should get credit in animal science. I mean, it just doesn't make sense to me, he said. If a kid's not in my building, but they're learning, then why can't they get credit for what they're learning? That idea that learning doesn't start and stop once you get to school or after you leave. Around student choice, voice, and agency, a mid-sized suburban superintendent shared with me, I've become a real fan of personalized blended learning classrooms, getting kids to own their education. I think it's a big thing, getting kids to early on understand where they are academically and where they need to go. And so that led me to create what I'm calling the framework for learning in a post-pandemic schools that really looks at creating environments that support the relationships and connections that are so important for learning, that we have learning experiences that really emphasize high expectations, rigor, real world opportunities, and that we recognize that learning happens anywhere, in our school, outside of our school, and with credit, so that we're actually putting value on the work that kids are doing. So it's kind of easy to talk about those things, but I'd love to, as we think about that, give you an example of what it looks like right here in Colorado. In the Durango School District, the Durango schools have leaned into what it means to engage in work around their portrait of a graduate. And so let's see if we can get this to work. Here we go. Okay.
Beyond what we can imagine today. Problems and possibilities that will demand empathy, resilience, creativity, agility, confidence, and courage.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning, Nina.
Whether this year's kindergarten student will merely survive or positively thrive in the decades to come depends in large measure on the experiences she has in school. Those experiences will be shaped by adults, by peers, and ultimately by the physical environments where she does her learning. United by our passion to promise every student their portrait of a graduate for future success, we are designing and redesigning today's schools for tomorrow's world. One example of how we are building for our students' future success is our Impact Center. When our community supported a bond to build a Career and Innovation Center, rather than look backwards at the former models of those buildings where one or two programs would be developed, we asked ourselves, what does the workplace of today look like? What would a building look like if we wanted the POG to thrive there? What kind of place would set students up for their success after they graduate? Our design team came up with a novel idea. What if we built a place where students would be able to engage in every part of the design process? They could empathize, define, ideate, prototype, and test. We came up with a building that is not adult-centric. It's not even program-centric. It's a student-centric place where they will impact their community by designing real-life solutions to real-life problems, putting their career and technical education to the test. The Impact Career Innovation Center is built to be a professional entrepreneurial environment that is flexible for relevance, celebrates the design process, fosters collaborative collisions, and is committed to sustainability.
Hey, you, call 911. Hey, you, go get the AED.
Using the same design ideas, we also want to renovate to innovate our classrooms so that students can gain industry experience, develop their POG competencies, and be future-focused in their learning. Check out this health sciences classroom. Last year was just a traditional classroom.
This space used to be a computer lab.
The teacher worked with his students to design a space with industry standard equipment, mimicking the layout of the spaces and tools of the health sciences field.
So we imagined this space being what you're seeing today. It mimics a hospital and a clinic setting, and the students have the availability to,
if you don't mind pulling your seat all the way up,
practice their skills repetitively to where they can master their skills. So when they get into an internship and they start shadowing clinicians, it's not the first time they've ever attempted these skills. The feedback is that it's awesome. The students are super excited. They love to do hands-on activities. They love that it's student-led, and they feel that what they're doing is meaningful.
And after this, I'm planning on getting my EMT. And then I'm going to look to do a Firefighter 1 class so I can become a firefighter / EMT out of high school.
The redesign of the classroom has caused innovation in the curriculum and changes in the roles of teacher and students.
How this would work in a real scenario is that
we are redesigning our instruction, student experiences, and our classrooms for a future focus as we empower our students.
Nick, what artery's down there?
With their life-ready portrait of a graduate skills. There are many other classrooms following the same renovation for innovation so that all students can find their passions and develop their life skills.
So that's an example of what the future in education looks like even today. So thank you for your time. I'm glad to be able to share this with you.